And good morning. Would you please take your 1982 hymnal and turn to number 597 for our gathering hymn.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah!
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now.
Thank you.
Most blessed Jesus, the only begotten Son of God's paternal womb, give us courage to live your gospel without compromise, that your reign may be established on all the earth, both now and to the ages of ages. Amen.
The first reading is from the first lesson of Acts. Paul and Silas had traveled through Amphipolis and Apollonia. They came to Thessalonica, where the Jewish synagogue. As was his custom, Paul went and on three Sabbaths presented to them from the scriptures, explaining and demonstrating it was necessary for the Messiah to suffer and to rise from the dead. This is the Messiah, Jesus, who I proclaim to you all. Now, some of those Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of the devout Jews and not a few of the prominent women. Then the sisters and brothers immediately that night went and sent Paul and Silas away to Beraka. When they arrived, they went to the Jewish synagogue. These persons were more high-born and open-minded than in Thessalonica. They received the word with great eagerness. Daily they examined the scriptures to see if these things were so. Thus, many of them therefore believed, including highly respected Greek women and not just a few Jewish men. Hear what the Spirit has to say to the Lord. Could you please join me in reading Psalm 63? I will read the first line. If you will please join me and read the second line. God, my God, I seek you. You, my soul thirsts for you. My flesh hungers for you, as in a dry and weary land without water. So in the sanctuary have I beheld you, seeing your power and glory. Because your faithful love is better than life, my lips will praise you. Therefore, I will bless you by name as long as I live,
while I lift up my hands.
As with a rich feast, my soul is satisfied, and with singing, my lips and mouth will praise you. When I recall you upon my bed, and in the watches of the night, immediate on you. For you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings, I sing for joy. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me.
A reading from the first letter of Peter, chapter 1, verses 13 through 9. Blessed be the God and Father of our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, who in great mercy has engendered a new birth for us into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, into an inheritance that is uncorruptible, undefiled and unfading, kept in heaven for all of you, who in the power of God are kept through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed at the end of time. And in this you rejoice, even when necessary for you to suffer various trials, in order that the examination of your faith, more precious than gold, which though perishable, is tested by fire, might be found yielding praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. You have not seen him, yet you love him. You do not see him now, yet you believe in him and rejoice with a joy glorious and beyond words. You are receiving the completion of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please join in our sequence hymn number 51 in the 1982 hymnal?
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. This week, on Thursday, the bishop held one of his monthly clergy calls. Ever since the pandemic started, we have all been meeting fairly regularly on Zoom. It used to be once a week for a couple of years back there, but now it's about once a month. And he uses this time to make announcements, talk about transitions and things like that. But there's always usually a theme, and if we're lucky, we have maybe 15 or 20 minutes, because they only last an hour, 15 or 20 minutes to talk about what that is in breakout rooms, where we are divided into groups of four or five and thrown into a virtual room, and where we randomly are mixed with others, and then we just talk about the theme. So as it happens, which is I'm discovering happening way too often for me, is that I end up with people I know really well. And it seems that we are always sort of in one configuration or not in the same breakout room. And the three other clergy I were with are all up pretty much in the North Country, some in the far north. And the question or the theme that we were asked to ponder was, how have you seen resurrection at work post-Easter? You know, what is new, what is alive for you now? And it was a little unfortunate that I was with this group, even though I love them all quite dearly, because they're in places that are not gonna last. We are gonna last. They are not. They have five or six people showing up on a Sunday. One said, in a year, I don't think we're gonna exist anymore. That was coupled with health issues that they've had. And it just seemed really dreary to me. It was exciting to hear that one or two young couples had appeared in one, and that was instant euphoria at the future of the parish, maybe. But still, when you think about it, not really resurrection in the sense the bishop was asking about. This had me thinking this week of things that were new, that were alive, that were sprouting in the face of decay or crumbling or being lost. I was not here last week because it was a fifth Sunday, and I'm not supposed to be here on a fifth Sunday of a month, but I took the opportunity the week before to drive down and see family members with Julia. And on our way back, we stopped at MassMoCA, the Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art in North Adams, Massachusetts, out near Williamstown.
and which is a gigantic factory that has been turned into a museum. And what's wonderful about it is that it can show gigantic pieces. It has room for enormous artwork. One of the pieces in this museum was a virtual reality room by a pretty well-known artist and musician named Laurie Anderson. And Julia and I signed up to go in it. So I don't know if you've ever been in a virtual room before, but basically you are led into a windowless space and you put on a kind of helmet with goggles that block all view of anything. And when somebody presses a button, the show begins, let's say, you embark on a voyage somewhere out there, in quotes, that is not real. You are thrust into some kind of space that is, they call it virtual, but it is kind of nowhere. So what you see in Chalk Room is, first of all, when you first walk in the room, all the walls are painted black, and the ceiling is black, and the floor is black, and there are four chairs, and you sit in one of the chairs, and you see chalk drawings that the artist has made on all the walls. When you put on the goggles, you go into the walls. You go through, things open, you go through the language, you end up in, you know, as if you're floating miles above the surface of the earth. And you have controls, and you can control where you go. And she's created this enormous, kind of endless place where you can explore. Why do I bring this up? Because this place was the most bleakest place imaginable. It was night. There was nobody there. It was a series of enormous, tall, building-like rectangles that went way up. And all of it is covered in chalk marks and drawings and sayings and language. And you could go all the way up to the top, or you could go through the buildings, or, you know, I call the buildings the spaces. And in the distance, if you made it to the top, which I did, you could see in the distance just a bright light and nothing else. It's apocalyptic. And if you are afraid of heights, this is not for you. Yeah. Because it's easy to imagine that one wrong move and you're gonna fall off and go all the way down there. And I did run into a wall by my mistake. There was a moment there when I was, you know, like this. I couldn't have been more interested, and I couldn't have been more just kind of dismayed that this virtual room was so bleak, a dystopia. So, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm sort of putting together images here because this is one of the most heartening, one of the most encouraging, one of the most enabling things that we read in the Gospels, that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He's speaking into believing. Believing in God, believing God is always there for us, believing that we don't live in this apocalyptic kind of place, that we're not in communities that are falling apart, that we are not nowhere and somewhere at the same time. We are grounded into the belief that God is always present for us. And Jesus takes this in John, to John's community in a way that says, believe in me, because I will take you to God. Believe into me. Embed yourself in what I'm saying. and embed yourself in what I am doing. And the point is a kind of a collective embrace. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, but he's really describing community, a community that is together, that works together, that is unified and loyal to each other to such a degree that he says, believe into me. He has a promise. The promise is that he will return. Jesus will return. And this fulfillment characterizes the life of John's community. Even when physically Jesus is not present, he is. Even when they find themselves lost, floating around in Nowheresville, he's there. Believe into me. So, how many people saw the coronation yesterday? Fair number. I ended up looking at it, though I didn't plan it. And what I saw was, it was sort of fun. I saw something that reminded me of this is perhaps a resurrection theme here, that a new leader, a new king is on the throne. And I was struck by the service in Westminster Abbey, I didn't see all of it, but I saw most of it, it seemed like Christ the King Sunday, before Advent, where Christ is connected with kingship and with authority and lordship, and it was like this language over and over and over again, and I thought, stop! This is not, if you want to do that, it sort of fits, but this is not how I see Jesus or Christ. You can see the power and the message and the just assurance as king-like, it's there and it's not going away. But when I think of Jesus, I don't want to think of wealth, ostentatious wealth. And I saw myself thinking too much about what are those big gold plates and, behind the altar? What is the jewelry, the everything? And I thought, what does that have to do with Christ? Is this just another virtual room looking out at me from my monitor? Is this real? Is this something that is decaying or falling apart, or we're just excited it's happening? Where is the verb do found in this? So Jesus, getting back to John, says, I don't have it right in front of me, but do what I do. Notice the works that I have done. And do, if you examine that word from its original, it's a simple word, but it actually means in this instance, in the way it is presented in this particular way, as to create. It has a creating aspect to it. So it's not just do something, like go pick up a book or do this. No, it's do something. Figure out, understand, come to a way of knowing that is beyond the ordinary, that is beyond yourself, that focuses on those who need doing done to them. I want to end by reading the original lyrics of the first hymn we sang today, the famous Jerusalem, which is almost a national hymn in England, trying to connect a little bit of today with yesterday. I mean, you know, King Charles is ostensibly the defender of the faith for us now, the head of the church. I want to be a little respectful of that. William Blake, who lived from 1757 to 1827, wrote this. "And did those feet in ancient time walk upon England's mountains green? And was the holy Lamb of God on England's pleasant pastures seen? And did the countenance divine shine forth upon our clouded hills? And was Jerusalem builded here among these dark satanic mills? Bring me my bow of burning gold. Bring me my arrows of desire. Bring me my spear, O clouds unfold. Bring me my chariot of fire. I will not cease from mental fight, nor shall my sword sleep in my hand till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land." In the first verse, you have a beautiful image of Jesus's way. In the second, you have an internal just struggle to get there, to do. I'm noticing a lot of battle imagery here, but there it is. Depicting struggle, depicting battle in ourselves. How do we walk the way of truth and life? So, what does resurrection look like to you? Let us stand and affirm our faith in that way, in that truth, and in that life with the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 358. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, and suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We ask in today's prayers of the people some special thanksgivings and blessings. We pray for an understanding, respect, and mutual love of all people that is automatic within us as an expression of Christ. With humility and gratitude, we bless and support the continuing voices and courage of all women, persons of color, and LGBTQIA persons in our country. We bless and support the work of the Little Blessings Child Care and the children therein as we hold fast to our commitment to assist the caregivers who are employed there. We pray for all immigrants and refugees seeking safe havens and a new life, especially for Khalid and Gul Khyber and their four children. We pray for the strengthening of democratic government in our country and around the world, and most especially the equality of rights for life, liberty, and justice for all. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Rob, our bishop, and for Richard, our priest. We pray for the provinces of the Anglican Church, for our diocese, for our ecumenical partners on the seacoast, and for our own parish. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our president, our governor, and the members of our courts and legislatures. Guide the people of this land and of all nations in the way of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We offer special thanksgivings and blessings today. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as Christ loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Remembering those on our parish prayer list, Paula, Lisa, Linda, Bob, Robert, Paul, Helen, Karen, Craig, Kathleen, Katie, Fran, Gary, Judy. We remember too, especially those who are having difficulty finding or desperately seeking employment or housing or medical care. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, heart, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring to them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, and particularly of late, the innocent lives that have been cut short by violence in our country and so many tragic and terrifying episodes. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them might be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share as well with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
we pray also for people suffering in countries burdened by political strife, tyrannical oppression, or cultural backwardness, that sanctions violence against the most vulnerable and does not recognize the liberating work of the Spirit. Lord God, hear the prayers of your people for compassion, justice, health, reconciliation, right relationship, and radical welcome. Through your Holy Spirit, you have made us one with your saints in heaven and on earth. Grant that in our earthly pilgrimage, we may always be supported by this fellowship of love and prayer, and know ourselves to be surrounded by their witness to your power and mercy. Grant us forgiveness for the wrongs we have committed, and give us strength to understand and correct them. We ask all this for the sake of Jesus Christ, in whom all our intercessions are acceptable, through the Spirit that lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
May the peace be always with you.
And also with you. Peace. Yikes. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ.
Joy to see you.
Joy to see you as well. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ, Barbara.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
Just a couple of announcements. Please keep in the front of your mind that in a few weeks we will be at Memorial Day weekend, and there is a plant sale and an event happening that day. Tina, do you want to say more to that?
Yeah. Thank you.
So let's start talking about that and make sure we make more than $50 this year.
So.
Thank you for clarifying that. That the date of that is the Saturday, the 28th, I believe.
It's Saturday, it's the 27th, before Memorial Day.
Before
the reason being, our attendance at advertising have failed. There's a lot of traffic that weekend, and we thought we would use the free advertising along with some of the Facebook advertising.
Okay. So I think we need to sort of get, up to speed with that and to just sort of, we can all talk at some point after the service, maybe even, just to sort of get our ducks in order and make sure that we do a good thing there. So that's coming up. Yes, Betty. That is,
can you say the date again?
The 13th.
Which is next Saturday.
Yeah, right. It's next Saturday at
2:30. 2:30, did you say? Sorry, I'm typing stuff into the chat. That's why I keep asking questions.
2:30. I do want to say that we mentioned St. John's Portsmouth there. They're just about to hire a curate. They've been seeking a curate for over a year and a half, which tells you something about the state of the church. And they've and the bishop announced that Aaron Jenkins, who is a is being ordained here in New Hampshire in a few weeks, will be the curate. And she's great. She is. Actually subbed with her at St. George's in Durham, and she preached, and I celebrated, and she was a wonderful preacher. So that's good news, new priest in our midst on the seacoast. And also, we need to welcome Leah Philbrick, who is, this is her first full week as the new priest in charge at Trinity Hampton. And she comes from England as well, so that's very exciting, and I'll meet her on Tuesday morning at our seacoast clergy breakfast at the Roundabout. We get together every month, so we pray for her and entry. Did you have a Betty?
That reminds me that two of us, including Reverend Leah, went to the Friday evening service at the temple in Portsmouth, and we had a really great time. They had a relatively new rabbi. She's been there for about 3 years. The service was guitar and chanting, some English, some Hebrew, but the Hebrew is transliterated, so you can follow along in prayer.
Mm-hmm.
They have a nice inclusive language that they're using. It was a time for fellowship with some people with wine and grape juice and sour bread and other foodies followed. So we had a great time, and she said, come back.
That's good. I mean, that's an excellent way to keep, not only to keep up, but to share in the ministry of our neighbors, our ecumenical neighbors, and interfaith neighbors. Thank you for doing that. Do not neglect to do good. Here's that word do again. Do not neglect to do good. To share what you have, for such actions are pleasing to God.
And while doing so, please join in singing number 194 in the 1982 hymnal.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praises.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets and their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, live freely and have your being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood,
therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption, and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our ancestors, God of Sarah, Ruth, Esther, Deborah, Mary, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Alleluia.
Celebrating, help, or joining with us online. In union, O God, with all faithful people gathered wherever the Eucharist is celebrated this day, I offer praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption given to us through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth, and for the means of grace and the hope of glory. I pray for Christ to come into my heart, my soul, my body, and my mind. Let nothing separate me from you. May I serve you in this life until, by your grace, I come to your promised reign of justice and peace in the unity of God, Son, and Spirit.
Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray.
Are we singing our hymn?
Ah. Yes.
Okay.
Let's sing our hymn first.
Yes, let us sing number 455 in the 1982 hymnal.
God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. May the blessings of God and Jesus be upon you, and may the Holy Spirit animate and electrify your hearts and minds and bodies and souls from this day forth forevermore.
Amen.
Okay, this last hymn is an old favorite. I want to belt it out.
And as we are sent forth, please join in singing number 518. In the 1982 hymnal.
Thank you.
chop chop lollipop.